As we start this month's theme of loving our church, we're going to start as you would with any building, with the foundation. In our case, we have, as the church, a rocky foundation. Now, you can take that a lot of ways. When things are rocky, we often think of things shifting around us, rocking and rolling. And I would think that is a good example of the church. The church, at times, does not seem quite as steady as we might hope or like. It's been shaken over the years from countless conflicts and reformations, like the one we'll celebrate at the end of the month. That was certainly a rocky time for the church. But I'm watching them build the foundation of our health center in Haiti, I noticed that they also used rocks. Big rocks. Rocks that they dug out of the ground and rocks that they put back into the ground, surrounded by mortar to become a foundation for that building. Solid as can be. Solid as a rock. The church, at times, when the world is shaking, has been just that. The place one could go to depend on. A firm foundation. But there's a play on words here, too. Because the church is a rocky foundation because it was founded on rocky. Which is probably the best way to translate Peter's name into English. Rocky. Like the fighter. Peter in Greek is Petros. Petros is rock. Peter was the rock on which Jesus would build the church. That was an intentional play on words that Jesus used. But we have rocky today as our foundation. And that might help explain how we've gotten to where we are, but it also might explain the best ways we can continue to be the church. To embrace and understand that we have a rocky foundation. But somehow or other, 2,000 years later, when most institutions, organizations, tribes, and languages have faded away, we're still here, still going strong. Maybe in numbers stronger than ever. So, a rocky foundation. Let's build on it. First thing I want to say, I'm sure I can get an amen for this, is I love the church. Amen? I love the church. I have loved it my whole life. There was never a time in my life where I turned my back on the church. I give thanks to my parents for that, to my wonderful people in my Sunday school classes and my youth group and the pastors I have had and the church people who've mentored me. I give thanks to all of them and the power of the Holy Spirit because it could have gone other ways. It could have gone other ways. But I've been blessed to be able to be in the church and to love the church my whole life. And whatever the situation has been with the church, I love the church. It's not always perfect. It's not always easy to be in the church, but I love it. And in just 1 week of photos from my iPhone, you would be able to see why I love it, and I think probably why you love it too, although your pictures might be different. There at the bottom is a picture of a whole group of people who left their homes here in Boca Raton and Delray Beach in Boynton, their homes that still had debris piled out in back and limbs down in their own backyards, left their own homes and went down to the Keys to help people in worse shape than we were. First time in my life where I came close to dehydration. I'd never had that before. We were working so hard. You couldn't drink enough water and Gatorade to keep up. We loved every minute of it, especially when we saw the faces of people. I'll never forget the widow who we went to help, who was absolutely overwhelmed, standing in the midst of basically a fallen forest all around her. And I'll never forget the look on her face when we raised her storm shutters and the light came into her living room. I love the church because the church was there. We were there. And I know your thoughts and prayers were there as well. The church isn't just inside this building. No, it's everywhere. And we were there and they know it. And they thanked us for it. I love the church. This week, we were all surrounding the flagpole here at school for See You at the Pole Day, where we all gathered together in solidarity with all the public schools that can't have Christian activity and prayer in the building, but can have it around their flagpole. So that's the day of the year we all gather. And I loved hearing the kindergartners pray for the homeless, and the fifth graders praying for Puerto Rico. And thinking, yes, I love the church because we are doing something about the hurt and pain in the world. Our kids are even on their knees praying. I love the church because, well, the church is a family. And last week I needed a family. And our praise team needed a family. Because just earlier that week our drummer had passed away. Unexpectedly. And we were heartbroken. You can't possibly know how hard it is to lose someone like that unless you've been in a band before. A band is like a choir. You're all brothers and sisters. You don't know each other perfectly. Some of you don't know each other well, but you're part of something when you sing, right? And when to miss somebody, and I know the choir's got empty chairs from people we've lost. It hurts, doesn't it? I got through the service okay, but at the end I was putting away my stuff and getting ready for this service, and you may have seen it if you came in early. The prayer team came up on the stage, and members came up on the stage, and they surrounded the prayer team, and they started praying, and lost it. I can't even think of the last time I cried so hard. So embarrassing. And so, cleansing and healing. Here's your pastor crumbling. But people were lifting me up at the same time. Hands on my shoulders, praying. Oh, I love the church. Thank you. Thank you for being there when my uncle passed away this year. Thank you for being there when I was a little snot-nosed kid making noise in the back of the church and you let me stay anyway. Thank you for washing me in the water and feeding me. Thank you for letting me have this incredible job. Thank you for letting me drink coffee with you and sing with you. Thank you. I love you. I love the church. Amen? I hope I just spoke the sentiment with different words than if you were up here. But sadly to say, not everyone feels that way. And there are people that hate the church. And it breaks our hearts, doesn't it? It breaks our hearts. Why? Why are there people that hate the church? Well, the church has hurt people. The church has hurt people. All through history, the church has hurt lots of people. The Crusades were a very romantic, you know, thing on our side of the fence, but if you ask Muslims, they remember it. It's when we came into their lands and killed them in the name of Jesus. Church hasn't always been right. Priests trusted with kids. Televangelists asking money from people who could barely spare it so they can have their planes and their big houses. There's a lot of people who, sad to say, have been hurt by the church. There's a lot of people that feel judged by the church today. They feel like they wouldn't be loved, welcomed. If in your identity there's an L, or a G, or a B, or a T, or a Q, I think chances are pretty good. You're not sure if the church loves you. Which, of course, the church better love everybody, right? We don't get to choose everybody. We could talk about expectations for people. We could talk about God's will all day long. But our job first is to love. And they don't believe that. The church they think, doesn't care. And you may have even said that when you went through a time and you thought that your friends in the church or your pastors didn't respond. If we didn't, please forgive us. And if you're going through something, please let us know. We are not mind readers. But most of all, and the church doesn't care, we let down people's expectations that there is some lighthouse. Some people hate the church because they say the church only cares about the past, stuck in the past, no room for any new ideas, no room for new people. That can happen. The things we love, we hold on to a lot, don't we? It can be really hard to see someone come along with something they love and want to make any changes or room. People hate the church for lots of reasons. Probably what breaks my heart most is the people that don't love or hate the church, they just don't care at all. Jesus said, either be hot or cold, but if you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out. These people just simply don't care anymore. They have no idea that the church has anything for them whatsoever. We had a memorial service for our drummer Greg on Monday night. The place was filled, I think, with people who might feel that way, like they don't know if the church has anything for them. I think a lot of people got religion that night when they noticed that when you get together and you pray together and you sing together and you care, great things happen. I hope it does for them. But all too many people are saying, I'm good without the church. And I don't buy that thing that you can have a relationship with God that continues to grow and develop without the church. I know that's the new rage now. I'm spiritual, not religious. I just know that without religion, without guidance and support and encouragement, spirituality fades. It's just another fad. I'm afraid for a lot of people who've taken that route. I love the church, so it pains me that people don't feel the same way. But maybe if we look to our foundation, we can better understand who we really are and communicate better to those who feel this way of what they can expect from the church. As I said before, the church has a rocky foundation. Jesus picked Peter out after Peter made the confession, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Some people have said that the real intention was for Jesus to build on that confession of faith. I'm building the church on what you just said, Peter. But no, it doesn't really read that, does it? On you, he says. And don't you think at times he might have made a dreadful mistake picking Peter out? Uneducated fisherman. It's doubtful that he could read. It's doubtful that he spoke anything beyond the rudimentary Aramaic that he would have learned in his area. He certainly wasn't a Hebrew scholar. He was impulsive. Rocky was a good name for him. It appears he had many rocks in his head. Peter. Why Peter? I mean, let's be honest, friends. If you go through it all, wouldn't you pick Paul? Huh? Wouldn't you pick Paul out of the crowd? Or maybe John, the one that Jesus loved? There might have been other choices, maybe better. Why Peter? I think because it's not intellect that grows the church. It's heart. And the one thing Peter had in abundance was heart. He wasn't always right. He hardly ever was right. But it's that heart that Jesus wanted to build on. And I think that's helpful. We are not a triumphant church. We are not a perfect church, a glorious church. We are a church blessed to be the heart of God. We don't always get it right. We don't give up. That's why loving, to me, is the most important thing for the church. Who is this guy, Peter, the one with the big heart? Well, he was a regular guy, right? A regular guy. And again, as people judge the church or as people seek to represent the church, they often do so in a way that makes it seem like we're something else. You've got the church lady that makes everyone feel like you can't measure up. You've got the televangelist with the slick hair and all the style and none of the substance. You've got the priest so holy you can't touch. All these images of the church are all about super people who float slightly off the ground. Honestly, I've never known a pastor like that. I've been blessed to only know real pastors. I've never known a church member like that. Sorry, none of you float off the ground, in my opinion. I've just been blessed to know we're regular people God uses in incredible ways. That's what the church is. He was regular. When I started church in Illinois, I was looking for really up-and-coming people, really cool people and important people and people with education, you know, like me. So it didn't really register when Gary and Debbie Bradley showed up at our church. Gary and Debbie in those days, you could know they were coming because you could smell the cigarette smoke on their clothes. Debbie never went anywhere without a cooler of Diet Cokes, of which she opened one during the service. Gary had a little different habit called Bud Light. Thankfully not at church. Their kids, clothes didn't match. Their house, falling apart. You couldn't meet two more unlikely founders of a church, but you know what? That's who God had sent to me. They became two of the most important people and remained so for 20 years at that church. Gary was our praise band leader every week for 20 years for free. And one of our bigger donors. Debbie helped us do a neighborhood evangelism program that was so special, our denomination wanted to know more about it. They asked us to write a book. We have a book out there on neighborhood evangelism. Regular people, that's who we are. How in the world can we let people know out there that hate the church that we're just regular people? No wonder we mess up all the time. All we got is hurt. That's all we got. We got no prosperity gospel to give you. We got no great insights into how to survive the storms of life. We just have each other, and God has us. And that's the church. Amen. Hey, even to emphasize this more, Peter was a coward. He's a regular guy, but he was a guy who, after all his boasting, turned out to be lily-livered. Do you know that Jesus they've arrested? No, I don't know him. Do you know that Jesus? I thought I saw you with him. Never heard of him. I'm sure I saw you there. Oh, you got the wrong man. I don't know him. A couple months ago, India passed a law about divorce. You could no longer divorce your wife verbally. It was still allowed in India. If you said, I divorced you, I divorced you, I divorced you three times in the presence of a witness, you were divorced, and she was out on the road. And lest we not remember, in many countries, to divorce your wife is to leave her in the lurch. She's not going to get a chance at remarriage. She's not going to be taken home by her own family. She's going to probably be on the street, and the guy scurries off to his next adventure. Peter and Jesus were disconnected at that moment. But what happens when Jesus comes back? He comes back and he goes to Peter. Hey, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord. Do you love me? Yes, Lord. Do you love me? Didn't you hear me the last time? Yes, Lord. And guess what? In three questions, Jesus brought Peter right back into the family. We are cowardly all the time as the church. People say things in our presence that we don't, with love, correct, because we're worried about our friendship. People represent religion in the wrong ways, and we're nervous about commenting on it because it doesn't seem right. Church stood by and even supported slavery in this country, closed its eyes and ignored, in many ways, the fascist activities during World War II that led to Holocausts. Even now, the church may be putting a deaf ear to the needs of people who still feel their cries for justice hasn't been heard here and around the world. I know there's many times I feel like a coward not standing up for our faith, like Peter. But God forgives, God heals, and God encourages. And the church again and again, like that day when Martin Luther took a nail, a hammer, and a piece of paper and stuck it to the door, the church from time to time rises and tells the truth. Let's pray for that courage. The world may see us being cowardly in many ways right now. Let us pray for the courage to take God's lead in these times that we face. Peter was an obstacle. Do you remember that time where Jesus said, "I must go from here to Jerusalem and die"? Peter said, "Oh no, Lord, you can't do that. I don't want you to. I like you. We're just getting to know each other. You have the words of eternal life." Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan. Get out of the way." Peter, it's not all fun and games. There's sacrifice. There's pain. For some people, the church is the obstacle. That's why a lot of people say, "I love Jesus. It's his fans that I can't stand." It hurts, doesn't it? It hurts when people say that. But we have to look honestly. How often have we been an obstacle? How often have church members and churches themselves been obstacles to people coming close to Christ? It's so important that we find ways not to be an obstacle, but to be instrumental in leading them to God. To be able to accept that there's sacrifice involved, that there's a cost. Peter was a faithful follower. Again, not the brightest bulb or the sharpest crayon. Just heart. Sort of like a dog that is lost, who sees you're walking by and starts to walk with you. That's kind of Peter. One day, Jesus just decided, "Oh, what the heck, I'll take him home." Faithful. Faithful. So faithful that when the time came, he said, "I'm willing to go to the cross. Just, I want you to do it upside down, because I don't want to look like my Lord and Savior. I don't deserve that." Quite by accident, at our first two services, the pyramid was upside down. Apparently, the last person who snuck it on there didn't see which way, and I don't think that was the altar team, honestly. I thought that's appropriate, though, because that's the cross that Peter died on, the upside down one. He was a faithful follower. That's what God demands of us, to be faithful. If we're going to be the church of the future, we've got to really challenge ourselves to be faithful followers. If you've been in the audience, if you've been skating across the top of this ministry, we need you to get down. We need you to put out. If you want to show your love for the church and to to make it a church that can love the world, we need everybody to do more than just show up. There's so much to do. And it's so easy to help. So easy. Embarrassingly easy. So what's stopping us? What's stopping us from giving as we know we should? Serving as we know we can? Promoting our church as we know it's needed? Peter couldn't help himself. I can't stop talking about Jesus. Faithful follower. We're going to encourage you to be a faithful follower in the next couple of weeks. We're sending out, and you'll be getting in an envelope, white one. Please don't throw it away. Open it up. You'll find in it a survey and a statement about a project we're considering for building here at Advent. We have been led in this direction for many years. And we want to know now if it's the time. We know we need it. Our ministry is growing. So please take the time to read through the letter you get and look at it. There won't be any commitments financially right now. But there'll be some questions about your support. Be honest. And as you're thinking about that, please be careful of two questions that can often hold us up. The first question, let me just be straight. First question you're going to ask, oh, I don't know if this is the right time. I don't know if this is the right time to do this. There's never the right time. There's never the right time. It's just one of those things, friends. The challenges and the opportunities come along when they come along. Second thing you're going to say is, well, it might be the right time for them, but things are tight here. They're always tight. They're always tight, at least in my house. I'm sure yours too. The question is it worth it? Do you love the church? You want the church to love the world. Faithful followers make sacrifices. Faithful followers climb on board. I hope you'll think about it. Be honest. Turn it back in. Let us know what you're thinking. Write as much as you want to on it. We'll read every single word. And we won't go ahead unless you let us know that that's where God's leading us. Finally, he was a humble servant. A humble servant. He acted very arrogant, but in the end, he was just a fisherman. I can't even possibly imagine Peter putting on that funky hat the Pope wears and the robes. I'm sure he never did. That's something they created later when pomp and circumstance mattered more than humility. You know, that's a big mistake for the church. Because what the world needs most of all is for us to be humble, loving people. Right now, it seems like it's impossible not to take sides on any issue facing us as a country, as a community. It is stunning to me how hard it is for anyone to find middle ground. It's empty. It's disappeared. There is no middle ground. Everybody wants to be for or against everything. It's wearing me out. But I'm an entrepreneur. I look for openings. And guess what? There's a new opening in this country. You know what the opening is? It's called the middle. And contrary to some people's belief, it doesn't always contain a fence. Sometimes the middle is where we need to go. You know what happens in the middle? In a fight, you're the one that gets hurt the most. So we got to be ready for that, right? But where it happens in the middle, too, is you can hear both sides. And when you're in the middle, you have a chance at reaching both sides. When you're in the middle, you create a new place, a safe place for people to go and say, I really don't know. I just haven't known anything but how to take sides lately. Our humility can be a great gift to our country right now. Finding the middle, listening to each other, learning from each other, being a bridge, a pathway, a safe place. I think it's an opportunity for us, a wonderful opportunity. People will look back and say, where was the church? Wouldn't it be wonderful to say this time around the church was right in the middle? Right in the middle of it. Loving, 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 loving. Refusing, refusing to fight, refusing to hate. Oh gosh, that's the church I love. That's the church. Well, I am quite certain each of you could preach this sermon. Because I know there's all sorts of things that you would say and you are welcome to tell me about them. Mine are just a few of the reasons why. Even though the church has a rocky foundation in every way of looking at it, even though the church is hated by many and now ignored by more, I think there's every reason for not only me to say, I love the church, but for us together to say, we love the church. Amen.